So you've probably seen this mining ship in several of my videos, but I have yet to explain its build, some of its evolutions, and what it still needs. In this episode, I'm going to really pimp out this mining ship and turn its already versatile construction into what might be considered the go-to ship for a compact, all-purpose build that can go anywhere and do almost anything. So this mining ship started with humble beginnings. I just wanted a large grid mining ship. What you're seeing here is version 1, but it was quite capable. It had all the things a ship needs for flying and was equipped with 4 mining heads, a large ore detector, 2 hydrogen oxygen generators to turn any ice into hydrogen, and a hydrogen engine to provide power to the hydrogen generators with plenty to spare. I'll talk more about that in a minute. To conserve space, I used these small containers for large grids so they could serve double duty as storage and to convey hydrogen to my thrusters, and basically anything else that needed to be part of the material transfer through the ship. Some folks hate using small containers rather than one large one, but for a hydrogen-powered craft, it saves a ton of space and gives a lot of flexibility. So, that was the base miner. But before it really got itself established, it went through some changes. It was a perfectly capable mining ship and worked fine to gather up my first load of ice, but I realized some more mining heads would be helpful. Move some engines around. It got its first update. But while asteroid mining in space, I also got my first encounter with the space pirates and took an immediate pelting before I could escape. Fortunately, the ship still flew, and I was able to take it back to my mobile base for more improvements. The ship got a couple more cargo containers, some more engines because it really struggled at full capacity, and a sleek decorative skin of armor blocks to provide some protection against the enemy drone firepower. It was light armor blocks and not a lot of protection, but I figured it would be enough to give me time to get away from trouble and escape without losing some critical components off the ship. With my improvements in place, including a tiny little small grid ejector, which turned out to be completely inadequate, I was off to mine some more in confidence. This is where this ship build got its first name as HM25, which stands for Hydrogen Miner with 25 Small Cargo Containers. I mined with it a little, and almost immediately replaced the single ejector with 3 ejectors, which were also highly inadequate, and added a small grid gatling gun on the back, along with a small grid cannon on the front. And yes, I was using either rotors or hinges to make those large grid to small grid conversions. I had another space pirate encounter on my next mining run, and the armor helped a lot to keep my components safe. But once my rear gun took some damage, I was rather defenseless. So more updates were needed. With a little more configuration, a 3 Gatling turret bank on the rear was my next move, and gave me that needed bit of redundancy and firepower. I also was focusing on protecting my rear, because while you're mining, you're very heads down into the rock in most mining ship configurations, which leaves the rear of your ship vulnerable. I'll also say that this 3 turret configuration worked very well, and did a great job of keeping the swarm of enemy drones enough at bay for me to mine the asteroid resources. Between drone waves, I was also able to go out and salvage some of the disabled drone parts to keep my miner repaired. Not bad. This whole mining, salvage, defense gameplay was pretty good. It was also a lot more exciting than just gathering resources alone. The HM25 got a couple more small improvements, like a low-profile connector for the ejector. But for the most part, this was the configuration I used as my mining ship for quite a while, and what brings us up to the present, with what I decided was the next level of improvements. It's been a good ship, but in actual in-game use, showed me a couple areas where it could use some upgrades, and the first thing to change was the landing area. I had been using the full-size armor blocks, but with the mag plates on the bottom of the ship it separated the space between the connectors to the point where it wouldn't connect very well. Changing those out to the blast door blocks that have a couple of the sides shaved down brought the connectors closer together and has given me great docking every time. I also added a little skirting around the blocks, you know, just for that extra bling. I do like the triple redundancy I get with the side-by-side turrets, but you can see here what I had to do to get it. There's a hinge converting to the small grid conveyor, then these branching small grid conveyor tubes eventually run to the turrets. So really, the only thing holding those Gatling turrets in place are those tiny little tubes. The edge all around the Gatling turrets is filled with small blocks, so it looks all solid, but none of it is actually connected by anything other than the tubes, so it's pretty fragile. And if things start taking damage, it can really start to wobble and get all wonky. The other thing is the ship's balance. The small grid components don't share the same physics as the large grid, so the gyroscope doesn't work against the weight distribution, and the ship does slowly start to tip backwards, just like I had in my prior video where I talked about merge blocks. It's not terrible, but it's a little annoying, so the whole mechanism has to go. I had the same hinge conversion thing to a small grid connector, and I liked the ever so slightly raised edge I could get with the small connector, but it had that same wonkiness going from large to small grid, so it had to go too. The small grid thing is also an issue when printing up a ship, as a single projector can only print a single grid size, so it's a little bit of a pain there as well. With all that out of the way, it's time for reconstruction. And I'm adding an oxygen tank to this whole mining ship build, but I'll talk about its purpose later. First, I had to move and play Tetris with a couple other items on the battery and ore detector to get it all set up. So, I need different large grid turrets. What I figured out overall is that with the large grid Gatling turret, I could place one in the middle, or by extending the rear of the ship one block, I could fit two. They only connect to a single sized block, but require three blocks of free space, so they need to be far enough apart. I also don't want anything extending out beyond the general shape of the hull, so the guns don't get banged up. To get this to work, and to have the Gatling turrets automatically fed with bullets from the storage, some more small containers, acting as conveyors and storage, were in order. With the guns situated, next were some connectors. Here's where things got a little tough. For the connectors to work as stone ejectors, I need a conveyor sorter. The conveyor sorter only has a pass-through back to front. It's a straight linear connection. So that required two blocks of depth to get the connector positioned and functional. And I couldn't place the sorter farther back into the conveyor chain with this configuration. I considered I could have them stick straight out the back, but I'd have to make the ship another block longer to keep them from overlapping in the space required by the Gatling turrets. Or I could create a short series with reinforced conveyor tubes and route the whole ejection system straight down. Now, I don't know if I'm going to like the way this looks or if it's going to work while mining, but I figured I'd try it and see. I could always come back and extend the back one more block and change it up. With the framework of functional blocks in place and the skeleton of the armor blocks set to give me a little aesthetic, it was time to use my new control room you saw in my last video and get it all welded up. What was cool is that you can see right in my upgraded control room all the blocks that need to be welded and their state. My drone welder made quick work of things with a single component load, so I was off to the next part of the upgrade. First, I want to have my fancy displays working when I'm out in space mining, so I can monitor my cargo capacity or see damaged functional blocks if I came under attack. So a programmable block in the rear loaded up with my subscribed automatic LCD scripts was perfect. You can see more about how to do that in my video on programmable blocks. I'll also have a link in the description. Next was a cryo chamber. A cryo chamber, you ask? Yes. This turned out to be a critical need when I used the ship on a multiplayer server. If you're playing on your own solo instance local on your PC, you don't need this. When you log out of a standalone game instance, the game clock just freezes and then picks up right where you left off, days or even weeks later. Not so in a multiplayer server. The game clock keeps running. Players and NPCs are still flying around, doing their thing the whole time you're away. Your refineries keep running. Your hydrogen engines keep burning ice. Everything continues, including your spacesuit's use of its oxygen supply. I bet now you're seeing why I added the oxygen tank. Connected through my piping system, that oxygen tank is more than enough oxygen to keep my person alive in a cryo chamber for days or weeks if necessary. And it was often the case that I was out mining somewhere and needed to log off for one reason or another. With the cryo chamber and oxygen tank, I never have to worry about my character dying, no matter how long I'm away. If I was only going to be away a few hours, then I could probably stay in my cockpit and live off the oxygen tank supply, but the cryo chamber uses oxygen at a much slower rate, so you can stay alive many times longer. There was also an inclusion of a survival kit to heal and to create some basic parts in an emergency, but my upgrades were not quite done. Next was a projector. Once this upgrade was finished, I could make a blueprint of the ship, and then with the projector on board the ship, I'd be able to overlay the ship with the blueprint projection. If any blocks get completely blown off, and the space pirates have been known to do that while I'm out mining, I can just turn on the projection and weld back the parts without having to place them or rotate around an armor block for the right form or placement. They're just right there, ready to weld, exactly as before. This ship, of course, now had more capacity, and it now totaled 31 small containers. So a change in the ship's name was in order. These upgrades so far were extensive.
I've made a lot of special modifications myself.
A move from small grid hinge conversions to more stable and fully printable large grid. A swap of 3 Gatlings to 2 larger, stronger ones. At least triple the stone ejection capability. Better display screens. And I do love my informative displays. The ability to log out in multiplayer servers, heal my character, and repair my ship. This ship was also capable of leaving atmosphere on a full gravity planet with oars on board, or flying in space. It can really do it all, including mining massive amounts of material. It's a larger capacity than 1 large cargo container. If there was one ship to build that would equip a player not just for mining, but to leave a starting base and go searching for a new, better location, this may be it. But there was one last alteration, the addition of 2 connectors on each side. What are those for? Well, I'll talk more about that in a later video when I go out to put this new and improved mining ship to the test. Till then, take care, and I'll be talking to you later.